All right, so it's 11 a.m. here in India. We'll get started. It gives me great pleasure in introducing Mr. Chandramouli to this webinar. And he, of course, needs no introduction. He is, but I'll still go ahead and do it. He is the CEO of Special Projects at Pidilite Industries and the best-selling author of Catalyst and now an upcoming book, which is Getting Better at Getting Better. So I can't wait for his talk, quite honestly. And right after his segment is done, I have a little bit of insights to share from my upcoming book called Clearing the Digital Blur. And post that, we will have a Q&A for about 15 minutes. So this is an hour-long webinar. And let's get started without much further ado. Over to you, Mr. Chandramouli.
Thank you so much, Rajiv. Good morning, everybody. Firstly, I want to thank Rajiv and Subbu for inviting me. It's an absolute pleasure to be able to talk to everybody who's on this webinar. The topic I'm going to talk on is success in careers. And I published two books on this. The first one is called Catalyst, which was published about 12 months back. And thanks to everybody's support, last year Catalyst was rated as the best nonfiction book on Amazon India. Just about 10 days back, Get Better at Getting Better has been published. Both these books have one objective, which is helping people succeed in their careers. I must give a disclaimer right up front to say I haven't done validation. So these books are not researched, validated books, but both these books are experiential books, which is what have I learned through my experience. So I would urge you to take what I say and read what you read as principles, because I haven't scientifically proven them. As a summary of career growth, when I find what is it that people who have had fantastic career growth do, they seem to have managed three levers very well. The first lever they have managed well is simply continuous improvement, or what I call getting better. They keep getting better every day, every week, every month, every year. You meet them after 6 months, you find that they are better than they were 6 months back. The first lever they seem to do well is just the simple ability to drive continuous improvement in themselves. The second thing they seem to have done well is make good career choices. The career management that they have done has been excellent. And it has been quite principle-based rather than emotional or temptation-based. And the last thing which I am passionate about is this whole concept of bringing life into the equation. I do think we have a mistaken notion that we succeed at work based on what we do at work. Yes, what you do at work makes a difference. But a lot of your success at work is also a function of the nature of person you are. And the nature of person you are develops in your life. So how do we bring the life into the equation of success, into career success? Is the third kind of lever that I want to talk about. I was joking with Rajiv to say I've never done a 30-minute pitch on my two books. I take normally a couple of hours. So I'm going to try and be very brief. I'm going to possibly just touch some very headline principles. And of course, if you're interested more, happy to connect in whichever way it develops. So the first starting point is this simple insight that I developed as I studied a lot of successful people, which is to say success is not about how good you are, but it is about how good a model you have to continuously improve how good you are. And in my book, this is possibly one of the most important things. I mean, I studied to say, I looked at different capabilities, analytical, creative, planning, so on and so forth. I tried to see if successful people were better in one or the other. I couldn't see any pattern. But the pattern that I found was that the most common factor amongst all successful people was the model they had to improve themselves. They just had a fantastic model of improving themselves. Now, when you want to improve yourself, where do you start? We learn and we grow and we get better through our experiences. Our experiences is about what we do. It's about the people we meet, as well as the books and the knowledge we get, training programs we attend, whatever you want to call it. That's the ocean from which we get better. But just the experiences doesn't mean you've got better. It's like you're attending this webinar now. There are 100 people attending this webinar, but all of them are experiencing the same thing. The experience is the same, but how much better they get is going to be different. Each one of you is not going to get better to the same extent of arising out of this webinar. And hence, your getting better is about how much of this experience have you codified into your human brain for responding for the future. Yeah. So the experience is the same, but how much you codify into your brain for responding to the future is really the getting better. And hence, I really believe that there is each one of us is what I call the get better model, which converts our experiences into getting better codes for the future. And I call this the get better model. Or another way of thinking about it, this is like a pipe between what we do and our brain. We can all do the same thing, but each one of us has different pipes. And as a result, what goes into our brains could be different. Now, most of us, when we want to grow, tend to focus on the experiences. To say, how do I do this more? How do I do that more? So on and so forth. We do not bring enough focus into saying, how do I make my pipe better? How do I make my get better model better? Where even whatever current experiences I am getting, I get more out of it. So it is like saying, you know, I have a house next to the lake and there are 5 houses. Each one has a pipe from the lake. If you need more water, either you can go to a bigger lake or you can make the pipe from the lake bigger to your house. And in work, I find that most people, when they want to grow, tend to focus on making the bigger lake. They say, I need to get a better experience, different experience. There is not enough focus on saying, how do I grow the get better model, which converts the experience into future codes for me. This happens because of 3 myths. Myth number 1 is a lack of understanding that each one of us has a different pipes. And possibly not realizing that maybe my pipe is actually inefficient. My get better model is actually inefficient. And hence, what I am doing right now, even from that, I'm not getting enough value. So first, lack of that recognition. The second, this notion that if I work hard, I must automatically be getting better. That is again an incorrect notion. Getting better is not a byproduct of hard work. Yeah, it needs certain actions and a certain get better model to convert your hard work into getting better. And the third, and I think one of the biggest failure points is the lack of recognition that age adversely impacts your ability to get better. Now, this is a truism. And all of us know that our learning ability when we are very young is much higher than our learning ability when we are very old. But how are we responding to it in our careers? The truth of our careers is bulk of our career is in the middle age and older age. It is in 30s, 40s, 50s, 60s, where your learning model is not as good as you were when you were 15. Now, what are you doing about your learning model in your career and recognizing that age is having an impact? So if you have an experience when you're 30 and you have another experience when you're 55, are you doing something when you're 55 with the recognition that my learning model has become weaker and how do I get more out of it is, I think, a very important aspect. And hence, my push is to people is to say, don't just focus on the experience and what you're doing. Put as much energy on improving your get better model, your pipe, to convert what you're doing into your brain. And to put focus on growing that pipe and making the get better model better, there are 2 primary insights I have. Firstly, to say, getting better is about deliberateness and it is not automatic. It is not that I just keep doing stuff and I keep getting better. We have to see of it as 2 objectives. One is to say I do stuff for results, but parallelly I have to do some other thing to convert that into getting better. And hence my definition of deliberateness is doing a set of things whose only purpose is to help you get better. So if I were to give you an example, I am a Tamilian, so I didn't even know Hindi in my childhood. And then my dad got a job in Ahmedabad. So at the age of 8, I went to Ahmedabad. And 6 months of playing cricket in the ground with friends, I learned Gujarati without even knowing Hindi. Yeah, I didn't have a teacher, I didn't have a class, anything. I just learned. But today, at 52, if I were to go to Russia, and if I just spend 6 months with friends there, I'm not going to learn Russian. Now, to learn Russian, I have to recognize that my learning model has gone down, and I have to be deliberate. And hence, I have to take classes, I have to educate myself, I might need a teacher, so on and so forth. Now, those are deliberate actions, which are different from just being and going along. So how do we bring deliberateness into getting better is, I think, the first strategy. And the second strategy is simply about the prioritization we put for getting better. I find that at work, most people prioritize getting results. They do not prioritize their own development, their own getting better. And that's really hurting careers in a very huge way. So how do we put the prioritization on getting better? And hence the summary for me is to say success is about a multiplication of effort into the quality of get better model you have. Most people in careers for success simply seem to focus on the effort. How hard I work, which experience I get, so on and so forth. They don't put enough focus on saying, how do I make my get better model better? And that's been the focus that I would like to bring. And I'm going to just touch on two very small principles on how to make the get better model better. The first one is the concept of saying, how do you get better by yourself every hour? I think one of the paradigms I want is this notion that, you know, I'm working every hour, but I can choose to get better once in 3 months. I'll attend a program after 6 months, I will get better. Or some special event will happen and I'll focus that for development. But the reality is development has to happen every hour, every day. If I choose to not develop as a result of this webinar and I hit the next webinar after 2 months, then, you know, I have not gotten ahead. So I have to get better as a consequence of this 1 hour. And I do believe every hour makes a difference. So I do want to give you a very small example you can relate with. So let's say three people, Ajay, Vijay and Sanjay, get hungry at night. So maybe it's 1 o'clock in the night. They get hungry and then they take their cars out and search for food. And these are three unknown people, so they don't know each other. They just, it just happens as a coincidence that they get hungry. So they take their cars out and search for food and they drive around randomly in the hope of finding a restaurant which is open. And after an hour of driving around, they reach a restaurant called Shetty's Restaurant, which was open at 1 o'clock in the night. And they have food there. Now, each of the three has spent 1 hour there. Yeah. The question is, how much better have they got? Now, for the future, Ajay thinks that the next time I get hungry at late in the night, I now know that Shetty's restaurant is open. So I will no longer drive randomly. I will go straight to Shetty's restaurant. So he has gotten better compared to where he was before he did this. Vijay thinks that I saw that Shetty's restaurant was opposite the railway station, which means eating joints have a high probability of being open opposite the railway station in the late in the night. So the next time I get hungry, I will drive to the nearest railway station. Now Vijay has gotten better even more than Ajay, because Ajay can find Shetty's restaurant only if he gets hungry in the same city. If he is in another city, when he gets hungry, then he has to do the process of driving around randomly again. But Vijay can find a place to eat in the night in any city as long as it has a railway station. Sanjay thinks Shetty's restaurant was opposite the railway station. The same logic should apply to all transport hubs. It should apply to a bus stand. It should apply at an airport. So the next time I get hungry in the middle of the night, I am going to find the nearest transport hub and I'm going to find food. So here is the situation. Each of the three has spent the same 1 hour. But the three haven't gotten better to the same extent. Sanjay has got better much more for that 1 hour than Ajay. And one of the questions I ask everybody to ponder is a self-assessment. How much do you think you're getting better for every 1 hour? Are you at Ajay's level or are you at Sanjay's level? And if you were to understand what is the difference between Ajay's getting better and Sanjay's getting better, Ajay is getting better stopped at knowing the answer to the problem. He was hungry in the night. He found an answer called Shetty's restaurant. And his getting better for the future stopped at knowing that answer. Sanjay's getting better evolved beyond the answer to what I call the method to finding the answer. Sanjay reached a point where he says, I have to locate the nearest transport hub. Now, that is not an answer, but that's a method to finding the answer. So really, the key push I have in the get better journey of people is, most of the time from our experiences, we stop at knowing the answers. Now, the answer will work only if the question is the same the next time. But the answer doesn't work if the question changes slightly. If it's a different city, a different suburb, a different country, then the answer won't work. The method to the finding the answer works all the time. So if we have to learn from every hour from our experiences, we should not stop at knowing the answer. We have to move to becoming an expert at the method to finding the answer. And that is the key paradigm that I try to bring out in the book. The second kind of paradigm, which I, as I said, there are two ways of getting better. One is getting better by yourself, through your reflection, through your self-thought, through your reviews. And the second is, how do we get better leveraging others? And my own sense is, all of us, including me, don't do good enough a job of leveraging others in our get better journey. So I made a very small video, which I would like to show you on that. Hello, 11 players and 10 support staff. Most professional cricket teams have large support staff. Batting coach, bowling coach, fielding coach, videographer, physiotherapist. The list is endless. Why do teams have such a large support staff? They exist for one reason: to help the players get better. A team whose players get better faster will win more matches. Do companies also have support staff to help employees get better? Yes, they have. Except that they are not called the coach or the physiotherapist or the videographer. Instead, they are called the boss or the seniors or peers or team members or HR. There are two ways of getting better. One is getting better by yourself, and the second is getting better by leveraging others. In the second way of getting better by leveraging others, we corporate employees can learn a lot from sportspersons. Compared to you and me, a sportsperson is a lot more willing to take help from others in their journey of getting better, be it coaches or senior players. In fact, a sportsperson is willing to let the coach dictate their lives. What time they get up in the morning, what do they eat, how do they exercise, etc. A sportsperson realizes that getting better is essential to success, and they have to take help of others in the journey to get better. We could do the same thing. We could leverage others for us to get better, be it our boss, our seniors, or even our team members. In fact, one of them could become the Ramakant Achrekar, who could make you a Tendulkar, provided you are willing to subject yourself to that coaching. The techniques of how you can leverage others to get better is covered in my book, Get Better at Getting Better, which is available online and in bookstores. My name is Chandramouli Venkatesan. I'm coming to you from Shivaji Park, which is the cradle of Mumbai cricket, with the aspiration that you hit a lot of sixes in your career. So that's, I think, the second principle, which is to say, how do we actually leverage others? And in the book, I've given quite a few examples of how do you leverage your boss, how do you leverage your team members, how do you leverage resources like training programs and books. In fact, I'm a book writer, but I do believe most people don't use books properly in their getting better journey. So I actually written a chapter in this book on how do you actually use a book to get better. So those are, I think, some of the things that I've covered in that. Coming to the second key piece, which is really around career management and how to make good career choices. You know, most of us have heard the story of the hare and the tortoise. And the moral, slow and steady wins the race. Sometimes when I do sessions in companies, I ask people, do you like this moral for your careers? And most people say no. You know, young people don't like the word slow for their careers. So if you say fast and steady wins the race, then they like it. But slow and steady wins the race, they don't like it. I mean, even I don't recommend that people be a tortoise in their careers. Tortoises will sometimes win, tortoises will sometimes lose. But I certainly recommend do not try and be the rabbit in your career. Rabbits will always lose. A 40-year career cannot be won in the first 10 years. A 40-year career is a marathon. We have to run across 40 years to win. So here is a moral I like for careers, which is careers have two halves, a first half and a second half. You know, it doesn't have to be mathematically equal. 20, 20 is not required. It can be 22, 14, 28, 12, whatever it is. But basically, my moral of the story is that win where it matters. And in careers, the only time it matters that you win is in your second half. Here is what I've observed seeing various people. What I've observed is most people are successful in the first half of their careers. And very few are successful in the second half of their careers. And sometimes I say it provocatively. I say even idiots succeed in the first half of their career. And even good people fail in the second half of their career. So if you really want to have a great career, the only thing you have to do is to figure out how will you win in the second half of the career. How will you win where it matters, where most people don't win? The interesting thing is winning in the second half of the career is not just a function of what you do in the second half. It's greatly a result of what you have done in the first half to build the foundation for winning in the second half. And hence, in career management and the choices that people make in careers, it's a question of what are the variables you're managing in your career. And there are two outcomes you can manage your career for. Outcome number one, a feeling of being successful. And outcome number two, preparing to succeed in the future. Many career choices that you make, both these outcomes will be met. What makes you feel successful also prepares you to succeed in the future. These are the easy career choices to make. But there'll be some career choices where what prepares you to be successful in the future does not make you feel successful here and now. And those are the difficult career choices to make. And in that, my push to people is please focus on career choices which prepare you to be successful in the future. Everybody wins in the first 20, 25 years. Less than 5% of people win in the last 15 years. Please prioritize career management to increase your probability of winning in the second half. And one of the poorest choices I see people make is how they make choices on how to quit a job, quit a company and join a new company. So I did make a small video for that as well because I was quite, I felt that this is an area where people make very poor choices.
Hello, everybody. Have you ever thought about quitting your job? Everybody has. Sometimes or the other in their career. I've observed often people make these decisions poorly. Quitting from your current job and joining a new company is a major decision, and getting it wrong can severely impact your career. People get this decision wrong because they often make it based on instinct and advice from others, as opposed to clear criteria and a good decision-making process. My book titled Catalyst will help you convert this decision from an instinct and advice-based decision to a principles and criteria-based decision. The starting point is to separate the quit and the join decision. To quit from your current company because you found a better opportunity outside can be a poor decision. In a marriage analogy, it is like leaving your spouse because you found somebody else more attractive. There must be valid reasons to leave your spouse, and that can't be, I found somebody else. Similarly, in careers, quitting because you found a better opportunity outside can be the root cause for many mistakes. You must have sound reasons to quit, which are different from the reasons to join elsewhere. If there is no reason to quit, there is no need to quit. Making the quit decision independent of the joint decision and before the joint decision is good career management. Once you disaggregate the quit and the joint decision, there are three questions. First, what are the criteria to make a good quit decision? Second, what are the criteria to decide where to join? And third, once you make these two decisions, how do you double check if you indeed got them right, because these decisions are irreversible. The book Catalyst, written by me, will help you make this decision well. My name is Chandramouli Venkatesan, and my aspiration is to be a catalyst for your success.
Last 3-4 minutes, I just want to touch on the last principle, which is really how do we bring life into the equation? Most of us have heard this wonderful term, work-life balance. There's a lovely cartoon here which says, the secret to having a rewarding work-life balance is to have no life. Then it's easy to keep things balanced by doing no work. Here is what I feel of work-life balance. I feel it's like a one-way street. The traffic flows in only one direction. Yeah. The only direction we are focused on is what is the impact that work is having on life. Unfortunately, we do not see the traffic in the other direction, which is what is the impact that life is having on work. And in my judgment, the impact that work has on life is much lesser than the impact that life has on work. And for whatever reasons, we choose to ignore the opposite traffic. And we don't ask the question, how can I live my life in such a way which increases the success probability at work? One of the great anecdotes of this comes from the life of Albert Einstein, the famous Nobel Prize winner and scientist, theory of relativity, E is equal to mc square, etc. If you Google Albert Einstein and music, he goes on to say that he believes that he was successful as a scientist because he was a passionate player of the violin in his life. In effect, what he is saying is what he did in his life made him more successful at work. In fact, on theory of relativity, if you Google relativity and music, he actually says the theory of relativity occurred to me as a result of my musical perception. So he's basically saying that what he did in his life made a difference to his work. I think we can do the same thing. I mean, if I were to bring an example to you and me, we know that, for example, in today's workplace, to be successful, you have to be a great team player. Nobody succeeds by being a solo artist. Now, if somebody has played a lot of team sports in their life, does it make a difference to the team skills that they bring to work? It does. So what you're doing in your life without you knowing is impacting you at work. Now, instead of it being accidental, Einstein played violin as an accident because he was born in a classical music family. You and me played team sports because we enjoyed it. We didn't plan it to say, I want to be a better team player at work. But instead of it being accidental, can we be purposive with our life? And there are two aspects of a life where I encourage us to be purposive. And again, covered in a couple of 100 pages in Catalyst, so please read it. One is our hobbies. I believe there are certain kind of hobbies which can transform your success at work. And I call them passionate striving hobbies. So that's one aspect. And second is really about your values and the personal values. And how do we make our values a catalyst for our success? So these are two aspects of how do we bring our life into the equation, which I want to leave you with. To just summarize, here is the way I see it. Majority of the workforce does not get better well. They have poor get better models. So if somebody wants to be successful, more successful than the majority, they have to improve their get better model. But if somebody said, no, I want to be absolutely in the top quartile, I want to be amongst the most successful leaders, then you have to solve the more difficult problem of how to win in the second half and career management for that. But if you want to go beyond and say, I want to be a legacy creating leader, I want to be one of the greatest, then you have to bring your life into the equation. So these are the two books. And to just quickly summarize, quite accessible in social media. My preferred mediums are LinkedIn and Twitter. Also, the videos that I showed you, I have a YouTube channel called Connect with Molly. I have about 23 videos there. So I look forward to interacting with all of you. And over to you, Rajiv.
Thank you so much, Mr. Chandramouli. So I think I've set myself up for something here to do. Something right after your session is a daunting task for me. So this was hugely inspiring. Thank you so much. So I'll quickly get into my segment. I'll just quickly share my screen with you. All right, so I hope you can see my screen. So in the next 15 minutes, so I've not done this in 15 minutes as well, so I'll try and hit the high notes in the next 15 minutes. So my presentation is about my upcoming book called Clearing the Digital Blur. And I will talk to you about, you know, some of the insights that I've gained through my interactions with CXOs of different companies, different industries. What are some patterns that we need to watch out for? And more importantly, how can we prepare ourselves in this digital age? So a quick introduction. I'm the founder and CEO of KNOLSKAPE. I'm a Bitsian, did computer science in Bitspilani, did master's in computer science in the US, and worked for Oracle in Silicon Valley for some time. And along the way, I got bitten by the creativity bug. And I was glad to hear that Mr. Chandramouli has a recommendation to get inspired by life and bring that into work. For me, it came through theater and filmmaking. So I dabbled into those areas, and one of my short films got selected at the San Francisco International Film Festival. So even today, when I think about leadership or, you know, the process of creating an experience for learners, I draw my inspiration from theater and filmmaking. So I did my MBA from INSEAD, and I write quite a lot for Live Mint and a few other magazines. I've done guest lectures for at IIM Bangalore, at INSEAD, and a few other B schools. And I've had a good fortune of doing 3 TEDx talks so far. That's a quick introduction about me. And this is the book I'm going to be talking about. It's called Clearing the Digital Blur: How Organizations and Individuals Really Can Transform Themselves at the Speed of Digital. So I'm a big fan of gamification and learning. So next few slides, being extremely mindful of the time, I'm going to make this a little interactive. What are we looking at here? What is this contraption that you see in front of you? Just to be sure, it's a real live person on the right side. I'm referring to the black object on the left. What's that contraption? So this is a 5-point question, if you get it right. And you can leave your answers on the chat window. And this is fastest fingers first. Balamurugan says it is colors. Okay, so I'm referring to the black object here. What exactly is that? It's a door. Okay, it has something to do with digital. It's a server. No, it's not a door. It's not a mega iPhone either. I've got that answer in the past. Okay, so good. Thanks for the answers. The answer to this one is, this is what is called as the IBM debater. What you're seeing in front of you is a debate competition between one of the best human debaters and the IBM debater. And we know how this story ends usually, right? We have seen this in the game of chess. We have seen this in the game of Go. And consistently, AI seems to be doing better in a lot of these things, which we used to think were uniquely human. The ability to play chess, I don't think any other species on the planet can actually do this consistently. Same thing with other games, right? So this is interesting to me because this is getting into the cognitive ability that we have. So for the longest time, we know in factories, you know, things have been automated. There's a lot of AI being used, but slowly it is getting into the cognitive jobs that you and I are engaged with, right? I saw this WhatsApp video which showed that in the Mercedes-Benz factory in Germany, there's just one human being who is looking at the entire production facility. And they jokingly say, for such a factory, you just need a human being and a dog. You might ask me, you know, why do you need a dog? Right? The dog's responsibility is to make sure that the human being doesn't mess up. And the role of the human being is to feed the dog. Right? So that's a level of automation that we are starting to experience, right? Not just in production facilities, but also lawyers. We are looking at bankers. So no role today, even writers, for example, there are AI-based books that are, you know, getting auto-created, poems being written, paintings coming out because of AI. So we are entering a different era, which we are not prepared for yet. Let's go to the next question. What exactly is this? What are we looking at here? All right, so this looks like a CRM system, some trend analysis, some pattern, but what is this device and which company do you think introduced this one? All right, I'm going to give you the answer to this. Some kind of an IoT. Good guess. SFDC, not software, not Salesforce.com. The answer is, this is an insurance company called Beam Dental Insurance. What they have done is they've introduced a smart toothbrush, right? So that's a device on the right. And on the mobile phone, you see your brushing patterns. I don't know if you can see this. It says session average, the duration for which you're brushing daily, whether you're brushing at all in the first place, the duration of brushing and how many times you do it. Now, the point is, this is not how insurance industry used to operate earlier, right? So it was one size fits all. If you're a 20-year-old, right, you got a certain insurance premium. And if you're a 60-year-old, you got something else. But today, because of data and personalization, you are getting an insurance premium based on your behavioral patterns. Now, today, this insurance company is getting into the space of smart toothbrush. What should Colgate do next? What should Pepsodent do next? They are not prepared to deal with this external company getting into their industry, right? So in all these examples, the point I'm making is there are certain lines that are blurring away, be it the industrial lines or industry boundaries or organizational boundaries or the boundary between the human being and the machine. Let's look at one more example because I find this very fascinating. What are we looking at here? Pair of shoes. What does this have to do with digital? What do you think is the use case? How high can you jump? For creating energy generation. Okay, that's a great idea. So the more you walk, the more your cell phone battery gets recharged, right? That's a brilliant one. That's a problem that we all have. That's a good one. All right. So do you also see that there's a Pizza Hut logo on this? What is Pizza Hut doing with shoes? I know what you're thinking next. You're probably thinking this is for the delivery boys to get GPS and for the company to track productivity. Are we making these boys deliver this at the fastest duration? But that's not what this is. So Pizza Hut has launched a series of shoes called the Pie Top series of shoes. And the interesting thing here is that you see a button on top. This is actually for the consumer. And when you press this button, you get your favorite pizza delivered to wherever you are. Now, when I first saw this, I thought it must be one of the two following things. One is it's a genius idea that nobody has ever thought of, or is it's just plain stupid. Who is going to press a button on a shoe to get pizza delivered to wherever they are? Now, if Amazon can do this through Amazon Echo and other things, why can't Pizza Hut do the same thing? But the point here is what we need to notice is companies are going beyond the boundaries of their core product, which is pizza. And they are really tracking the customer experience journey. Maybe, I'm just guessing here, maybe they are thinking there are quite a lot of us, start of the year, we've made a promise to ourselves that we will jog or run this year, right? And that's a tough thing for all of us to do. And once I've completed a run, maybe I want to reward myself. And that's when I will look down at my shoes and I'll press a button and I get a pizza. So that's the cue, the reward, and the routine, the habit loop getting formed. Maybe that's what they're thinking. I don't know what it is. And time will tell if this is a marketing gimmick or it's pure genius. So in all of this, the point I'm trying to make is companies are starting to go beyond and they are breaking all kinds of barriers in terms of what they can do with digital. Just so that we all get aligned on what is this digital we are talking about, because anytime you ask this question to anyone, you get different answers from ones and zeros, to automation, to paperless. We are all looking at this elephant, completely blindfolded. So to me, digital is not a thing. Just because you've got a mobile phone or a social media presence, that doesn't make you digital. It's a way of doing things, which is why we say digital is about mindsets more than the technology. It is more about business models more than technology. So in this story, we are obviously leveraging technology, but because it allows you to scale. But really, it is done for achieving three outcomes. One, creating exceptional experience, be it for the customer or for ourselves, for employees. Second, becoming agile. And third, unlocking new value. Think about it. It's not like we did not have cabs 5 years, 7 years ago. Today, there's a software layer that is engulfing cabs as an industry, and it's extracting billions of dollars. Which company am I referring to? Uber, of course. It's not like we did not have spare rooms in our homes. Today, there's a software layer that has wrapped itself around this, and it's extracting billions of dollars. So that's unlocking new value. And the secret to unlocking new value is data. And that's why people say data is a new oil, or it's a new soil, whatever, you know, tickles your fancy. But the real story here is when you look at the top 10 companies worldwide, right, 5 years ago, based on market cap, what sort of companies would you have seen on that list? You'd have seen major banks. You'd have seen oil companies, ExxonMobil, for example. Today, when you look at that list, 7 out of the top 10 companies by market cap are all software platforms, which is why a few years ago, Mark Andreessen said, software is eating the world. More precisely, software platforms are eating the world, right? And that's a world that we are living in at this point in time. So this is a quote from Pierre Nanterme, the ex-CEO of Accenture. I don't know if you read the news. He passed away, unfortunately, yesterday. And so he's one leader I was looking up to. It's a pretty sad news. He said, digital is a main reason why over half of the companies on Fortune 500 list have disappeared since the year 2000. So when you ask this question, but why? What's the issue? Because 250 companies dropping out of this list in the last decade and a half is unusual. Right. The usual responses that you get is, oh, we did not change fast enough. We were not agile enough. We did not change our business model. All those are fantastic answers. But when I started researching on this topic and I started talking to many companies, both incumbents and digital natives, what I found was some of the lines that we are used to from the industrial era, these lines have started blurring away. Digital natives have no illusions around these lines because they know that that these lines don't matter anymore, but the large incumbents are still holding on to them. That is causing severe disorientation for them. Now, the question is, what sort of lines are these? Firstly, digital blur. Blur is an acronym which stands for boundaryless organizations. Now, if you think about Uber, Airbnb, Skype, many of the digital native companies, I'm sure you've seen this statistic somewhere. Uber owns zero cars. Skype has zero network towers. Airbnb has zero rooms, right? So the whole point here is the mental model of the industrial age was ownership, that I need to own all of these things to succeed. And you dominated the pipeline, right? So that pipeline thinking has given way to platform thinking, where access is more important compared to ownership, right? So that's boundaryless thinking. Second is limitless digitization. Everything that we see in front of us, from a chair to a table to a car, everything is getting digitized. So GE calls this digital twins, right? Every physical object that you see in the real world can have a twin on the cloud. This allows for rapid prototyping. It allows for, even the manufacturing industry is going to get revolutionized because of this. And in this era, we will have to deal with a lot of so-called intelligent devices around us, a lot of data. And the question is, how will we deal with all of this complexity? Unbounded innovation is about industry lines blurring away. If you think about automated cars, it's not just going to impact the auto industry. There are at least 15 industries you can now sit down and think about that have to rethink their game if and when this goes mainstream. And that's just one innovation that I'm talking about. If you add blockchain to it, if you add bitcoins to it, if you add quantum computing to it, and there are about 30 such trends that are here and now, right? And these technologies have the potential to alter industry lines as we know it. And lastly, relentless iteration is a story of how time dimension is blurring away, the now, new, and the next. In the industrial era, this was thought of as a 5-year horizon or a 10-year horizon. But today, all of these, the now, new, and the next, are all playing out at the same time. Classic example is Uber. In their current business model, the now for them is to add more cars in the network, more drivers in the network. That's what they're working on. But at the same time, the new for them is, how do I make use of driverless cars to get to profitability? They need to go IPO sometime, right? So how do I get to profitability? But already the next for them is flying taxis. And what's mind-blowing about that is, next year they are saying they're going to be launching flying taxis. They will be competing against Boeing. Now get that. So the industry lines blurring away, a taxi company competing against one of the largest airline companies in the world. So I'm waiting to see how that will play out, right? So hopefully this gives you a clear idea on the lines that are blurring away. So in terms of what do we need to do about all of this, right? So when you think about boundaryless organizations, can we think outside in? Because there's a lot of stuff that's happening outside that we need to bring into our organizations, even to our mindsets. Limitless digitization, can we start honing our sense-making skills? They say 90% of world's information was created in the last 2 years, right? And we are exponentially adding more data and more noise to it, right? So in this era, the ability to connect certain dots and say, hey, here is a pattern making, and the ability to narrate a story that others will understand easily, right? And so it can become actionable. I think that's some competency leaders have to build. And design leader, because you're designing experiences more than anything else in the digital age, how can we all become designers in our mind? Think like game designers. And finally, agile leaders, not just in the way projects happen, but also strategic agility, so that we can change direction of the company as and when things change outside. So these are some competencies that we need to build, but I'm sure that's at a high level. On a day-to-day basis, there are some things that we can do. Number one, build networks with thought leaders and doers, people who are actually prototyping and getting stuff out. So I'm not sure how many of us are active on Twitter or LinkedIn or any of these social platforms. If you think about it, it's very difficult to keep up with many of these technology changes. The best way to keep up is to follow the right kind of people on these platforms. It's okay if you're following Abhishek Bachchan, but don't expect to become a digital leader at the end of it. So the people you have in your network is extremely crucial. Second, develop an outside-in perspective. What got you here will not get you to the digital age. So we need to develop a different kind of a mindset where you say, I don't know. It is completely okay. Be humble enough to say, I'm a great expert on this, but in the digital age, the rules are getting rewritten. So develop humility and an outside-in perspective. So many of us tend to think that we need to become programmers and all of that to get on top of digital. To me, first developing a working understanding of these technologies and appreciating their impact, right? That goes a long way. Embracing data analytics. I think this will be a core digital skill. This is digital literacy, just like numerical literacy or linguistic literacy. This is data literacy. We need to get better at it because digital age thrives on data. Commit to lifelong learning. And as Mr. Chandramouli was talking about, invest in your capability development. Your company may not do it. The government is trying, but that may not touch you. What are you doing for yourself, right, to stay relevant and to thrive? And as I said earlier, think like a designer, pick problems that matter, try and approach it from a designer lens, stay curious and develop an experimenter's mindset. Don't start by thinking, I know it all, right? Construct a hypothesis and try and prove or disprove your hypothesis and be relentless at it, right? So this is how on a daily basis you can change certain habits and prepare for this. I know I'm a little over time. This is going to be my last quiz question and I will pause here. Who is this gentleman? All right, any answers? I'll give you a clue. He is a champion from a game. And he has a digital story. Any guesses? He's a champion. Can I give you the answer? Yes, Armstrong, you're right. Chess. So what's his name? Yep, Paris got it right. So this was a 100-point question, Paris. So you can redeem this at your nearest cafeteria. So Gary Kasparov, so in case you've not watched his TED Talk, please take 15 minutes and then watch it because what he is offering you is a very compelling, inspiring narrative. So the one thing that you will see in the press and from the media is AI is coming. It's going to take over our jobs. That's what I started with as well. I want to end this with an empowering narrative, which is if you partner with intelligent devices and we get ourselves better at it, I think we will be in a safer place. So from his story, you know what happened to him, 97, 98 time frame, he lost to the IBM supercomputer. There were two contests. The first one he actually won. Nobody talks about it. The second one he lost and that becomes headline news. What happened between the two contests is that the machine learned, the human did not, right? And so he said, this is an unfair contest. The machine has access to a lot of data. Hook me up with a computer as well, and let's see what happens. So they started doing research around the human-computer combination. And in the year 2014, freestyle chess championship, guess what happened? The human plus machine combination systematically beat the machine. To me, that's an empowering story, right? And that's a story we all need to believe in and do something about, right? It's a choice in front of us. Either we give up or do something about it. And I'm willing to place my bet on humans because we are smart. We've evolved through ups and downs, and I think we don't have to shortchange ourselves. So please do watch that video. I hope it inspires you like the way it did for me. So that's pretty much what I wanted to share with you. These are my coordinates. I'm active on both Twitter and LinkedIn. You can connect with me anytime. Now the floor is actually open to you. Please feel free to ask your questions. Okay, do we have questions? Excuse me. Okay, so Lokesh is sharing a few lines from Rabindranath Tagore's book.
I saw Nitish Mishra's question. It's so confusing these days with so many technologies. And I think one of my beliefs of writing Get Better at Getting Better was to say, what do we want to focus on? Do we want to focus on the domain, or do we want to focus on our learning capability? There are two ways of dealing with the future. One is to say, I back myself to anticipate which domain will become important, and I skill myself in that domain. The other way is to say, I build my learning capability such that whenever I reach the future, whatever is the domain that is important, I will learn it then. Yeah. And there are two ways of going at it. I find that most of us have the tendency of now saying, oh, AI is important. Oh, pollution is important. Sustainability is important. Let me educate myself there. But when you get to the future, maybe there's something else there. So I think I'm not talking either or, but I think it's important to say, I build my learning model such that when I get the future, I can learn then also.
Yeah, that's a great point. So in my experience as well, sometimes we get carried away by technologies, right? So these are ultimately tools or enablers for solving a problem or to create an opportunity, right? Sometimes we lose sight of what does a customer want, what is a problem we are trying to solve, and we overinvest in technologies and we go too far with it, right? And then there are fads, there are technologies, and today it's coming at a very rapid pace, and one cannot keep up with all of those. So instead of focusing on the evolution of the technology, which is why I said develop a working understanding, but more important to focus on the problem that you're trying to solve. Sometimes you don't need these technologies to solve a problem, right? Sometimes we take it too far. So which is why I think the problem domain, the technology, the business context, I think it should all come together. It's not a standalone area of learning. Okay, any other questions? Did we leave you all speechless, or what's happening? So maybe while we are waiting for further questions to come up, Mr. Chandramouli, if I can ask you a question,
sure.
Right? What would be your recommendation for, let's say, middle managers specifically, right? So when we work with companies, here's what we understand. You know, the younger folks in the digital age are probably far more ready to adopt, technologies and run with it. And they have a long runway as well. And leaders probably in their 50s, we see resistance that, okay, maybe I have 5 more years. Should I get into all of this right now? So there is a certain mindset there. And the people in between who are working, like you mentioned, they've invested a lot in the first part of their career. Now they are realizing that all that I've learned in the first half may not be applicable in the second half because the rules are changing. So what would be your recommendation for people who are at the cusp of that transition, where the lessons they've learned in the first half may not be applicable?
Yeah.
Nothing, excellent question. Let me share a personal example, Rajiv. I'm a career marketer. I started in 1991 after my MBA, and in the time I started marketing, the dominant medium of marketing was print and newspapers. Then I learned how to do marketing on the television, through television advertising. And I do believe that I became a successful marketer. And then 28 years down the line, I launched my book. And I find that, you know, the marketing skills that I knew, which is both television and print, I don't have the money to be able to do marketing in that. So those take crores of rupees. And I have to, you know, market in a few lakhs of rupees. And suddenly I had to become a digital marketer. Right? And here I am, 28th year of my working, and I have to become a digital marketer. And I learned digital marketing, and I started, you know, learning that game and doing it. And in a few lakh of rupees, I could create a successful book. And I think the answer hence lies in exactly what you said, which is, are you focused on the means or are you focused on the problem you're solving? I think the more we start thinking that this is a skill I have, and let me search a problem to solve for this skill, you go wrong. The more you come from saying, this is the problem I have to solve, now how do I develop the skill that I need to solve that problem, the more successful you become. I think most of us have that capability to start from the problem and develop the skill. So it is not a capability issue, it's an approach issue. Our approach tends to be, this is a skill I have, now let me solve the problems which that skill can solve. And I think changing the approach is really the key.
Okay. And there's a question from Lokesh. Probably we'll take one more question. The other question I had was today, the millennials, they're talking about gigs, right? So it's actually in the context of gig economy. I might spend 6 months in a company, gain some experience, and then do something else. So they're not talking about a linear career progression. Whereas in your book, you're talking about taking that decision wisely and be careful about those three questions that you should ask. So what will be your recommendation for millennials who have a different idea of career management? So that's question one. Question two is from Lokesh. How to get not overpowered by empowered about technology in all walks of life?
So I think on the career management for millennials, and to say, you know, I'll change every 6 months, I'll change every 12 months. I think as long as you have concrete logic, I'm fine, you know, but in many of these cases, these seem to be fads without logic. Yeah. Now here is how the learning model builds up in your head. I have this concept called learning cycles, which is to say that you do something, you see the results, as a consequence, you correct what you do and see the results again. Now this is how the learning model builds up. Now in many things that we do at work, this thing takes 12 months, 18 months, 24 months, 36 months, depending on what you have done. Now, if you participate in many learning cycles for only half the time, which is you learn, do what you do, you don't see the results, you don't correct and you don't redo, you don't have a learning model, you don't learn.
Yeah.
You've done a lot of stuff. Yeah. So I am not an arguer of saying spend 3 years in a job or 6 months in a job. I'm an arguer of saying, please complete learning cycles. Sometimes the learning cycles could be 4 months. Sometimes it could be 4 years. Yeah. But you have to complete learning cycles. And hence, you must have a very logic-based career decision-making.
Yep.
As opposed to a fad-based decision-making.
Okay. That's a great point.
Because 1,000 people leave in 6 months, it doesn't become right.
Yes. And I think Balamurugan's question is also along the same lines. He's saying people who move frequently are growing exponentially, but people who have a longer time horizon, they move slowly. How do you relate to this?
No, I think, and again, it's a question of how do you define growth? Because in a very short term, you can end up defining growth as somebody's title, somebody's salary, somebody's apparent title. You know, you change three jobs, you go from assistant manager to manager to senior manager. So it looks exponential. But as I said, that's why it's important to anchor the career. And I believe that most people succeed in the first half and very few succeed in the second half. So when you actually look at that lens and say, you know, in the first half, somebody did 20 jobs and there is another person in the first half who did 4 jobs. I mean, I think there is a much higher probability that in the second half, the person who did 4 jobs is going to be more successful. So it's a question of how we define growth, which over what time frame.
Okay, that's a good one. So I do realize that we are out of time. Thank you so much, everybody, for participating in this webinar and keeping this interactive. Once again, thank you so much, Mr. Chandramouli. Best wishes for the success of this book as well, and look forward to learning more and more from you through the different channels online. Thank you so much.
Thank you, Rajiv. Thank you, everybody, for attending.
Thank you. Bye.